नमस्कार, आप देख रहे हो न्यूज़ में, मनीषा आप सभी का स्वागत करती हूँ और आप लोगों के बीच हाजिर हूँ एक ऐसे कॉन्फ्रेंस को लेकर जहाँ पर बहुत सारे डॉक्टर्स यहाँ पे उपलब्ध हैं और बहुत सारे डॉक्टर यहाँ पे शामिल हो रहे हैं, जिनमें हैं डॉक्टर जो है प्रोफेसर ओपी सिंह, डॉक्टर मुर्गेश वैष्णव, प्रोफेसर ई मोहनदास, डॉक्टर आदर्श त्रिपाठी, प्रोफेसर TSS राव, डॉक्टर विहांग वाहिया, डॉक्टर सुरेश वड़ामात, जो कि दूर दूर से लोग आए हुए हैं और एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक पर बात करेंगे जो है सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर, यानी कि जो मेल सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर्स होते हैं ED एंड PME, यानी कि उस पर आज चर्चा करेंगे, अपनी जानकारियों को साझा करेंगे, लोगों को अवेयर करेंगे और आपकी जो जिज्ञासाएं हैं उनको शांत भी करेंगे। तो आइए देखते हैं कि क्या है कॉन्फ्रेंस हॉल में और क्या जानकारियाँ वो लोगों को देते हैं, तो आइए शुरू करते हैं।
राजधानी लखनऊ के विभूतिगंज स्थित होटल हिल्टन गार्डन इन में एक साइंटिफिक प्रोग्राम का आयोजन किया गया, जिसमें मुख्य अतिथि के रूप में डॉक्टर मुर्गेश वैष्णव रहे, साथ ही जहां पर स्पीकर प्रोफेसर ओपी सिंह, डॉक्टर मुर्गेश वैष्णव, प्रोफेसर ई मोहनदास, डॉक्टर आदर्श त्रिपाठी, प्रोफेसर TSS राव, डॉक्टर विहांग वाहिया, साथ ही डॉक्टर सुरेश बड़ा माथ रहे। आपको बता दें, इस प्रोग्राम का मेन उद्देश्य लोगों में सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर के प्रति अवेयरनेस को फैलाना था, जिसके अंतर्गत मेल सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर पर बात किया गया, साथ ही जिसमें चेयरपर्सन डॉक्टर विनय कुमार, डॉक्टर संजय गुप्ता, डॉक्टर आशीष कुमार श्रीवास्तव, डॉक्टर जी प्रसाद राव, डॉक्टर गौतम साहू, डॉक्टर कृष्णा कदम, डॉक्टर KK मिश्रा, डॉक्टर विपुल सिंह, डॉक्टर दर्पण कौर, डॉक्टर TP सुधाकर, डॉक्टर उत्तम गर्ग, साथ ही डॉक्टर अलीम सिद्दीकी के साथ साथ डॉक्टर RK महेंद्रू, डॉक्टर रजनी चटर्जी, डॉक्टर वेणुगोपाल जवाहनर, डॉक्टर PK दलाल, डॉक्टर शशि राय, डॉक्टर सुप्रिया अग्रवाल, प्रोफेसर SC तिवारी, डॉक्टर SP गुप्ता, डॉक्टर सुजीत साहू उपस्थित रहे। आपको बता दें कि इस प्रोग्राम में आए हुए गेस्ट ने तमाम तरह की दिक्कतों के बारे में बताया है, जो कि एक कॉमन पर्सन के सामने आती रहती हैं। साथ ही उन्होंने और भी तमाम जानकारियां दी, जिसमें मुख्य रूप से सेक्स थेरेपी क्या होता है, सेक्स थेरेपिस्ट कौन होते हैं, मैनेजमेंट ऑफ PME, मैनेजमेंट ऑफ ED यानी कि इरेक्टाइल डिसफंक्शन आदि जानकारियां लोगों के समक्ष प्रस्तुत की गई।
हेलो, मैं डॉक्टर आदर्श त्रिपाठी हूं। मैं KGMC मानसिक चिकित्सा विभाग में एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर के पद पर कार्यरत हूं। आज जो प्रोग्राम हम लोग कर रहे हैं, आप सब जानते हैं कि सेक्सुअलिटी किसी भी इंसान के जीवन का एक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण अंग होता है और बहुत बार लोगों के जीवन में ऐसी समस्याएं आती हैं जिनको कि सेक्स से संबंधित बीमारियां कहा जाता है, सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर्स कहा जाता है। ये एक ऐसा टॉपिक है जिसमें हमारे देश में जनरल पॉपुलेशन में भी बात बहुत कम होती है और अनफॉर्चुनेटली मेडिकल प्रोफेशन में भी सेक्सुअलिटी और सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर्स पर टीचिंग और ट्रेनिंग काफ़ी कम होती है। तो इस नीड को और इस ज़रूरत को ध्यान में रखते हुए आज का ये प्रोग्राम प्लान किया गया है और इस प्रोग्राम में के जरिए मुख्य उद्देश्य इसका यह है कि जो डॉक्टर्स अपनी पढ़ाई कर रहे हैं या जो डॉक्टर्स प्रैक्टिस में हैं, वो सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर्स के बारे में ज़्यादा कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव तरीके से समझ सकें, उन बीमारियों को अच्छे ढंग से डायग्नोस कर सकें और इलाज को ज़्यादा बेहतर ढंग से मैनेज कर सकें। तो करीब 150 पार्टिसिपेंट्स ने इस प्रोग्राम में भाग लिया है और लगभग पूरे भारत के लगभग सभी हिस्सों से लोग इस प्रोग्राम में पार्टिसिपेट करने के लिए आए हैं। थैंक यू वेरी मच।
Responsible for premature ejaculation, and he very well pointed it out that premature ejaculation is a psycho, neuro, uro, endocrinological disorder, that it involves multiple factors: psychological, neurological, urological, endocrinological disorders. So once we are thinking about management, we need to keep in mind that how we can influence these systems for improving the management. One of the important concept that is very useful in clinical management is Waldinger's and Schwinger's classification. As Mohandas sir already pointed, this classification is very meaningful when we are thinking about management of case with premature ejaculation. And we did a small study last year, and just to show that what is the clinical situation when these patients visit to clinic. So in our study of 102 patients, we found that the patient visiting psychiatric psychosexual OPD, patients with lifelong premature ejaculation, acquired premature ejaculation, and PLED, these three types are present. There were no patients of natural variable premature ejaculation. And the most common type was acquired premature ejaculation. And they also have a huge comorbidity, that they have 60% sexual comorbidity, and most of those comorbidities were erectile dysfunction and Dart syndrome. Then they have psychiatric comorbidities, mainly anxiety disorder and depressive disorders, and lot of physical comorbidities including diabetes, thyroid dysfunctions, hypertension, and some other infectious disorders. Another point that Dr. Mohandas sir was mentioning, that in studies conducted across nations, this is data from community studies, and there are huge variation among different countries. Reason for the same are not known as of now because of lack of large studies. So USA, the time somewhere is 13.6 minutes, to Italy where it is 9.6 minutes, and as pointed out by sir, in India it's somewhere between 5 to 6 minutes. So to talk about management proper, based on this etiopathological understanding, there are certain potential targets for management of premature ejaculation. By saying potential target, I would like to tell that these are areas where we can deliver some intervention to make premature ejaculation better, but you know what, all of these studies are available for clinical use as of now. So there are some targets in central nervous system related to serotonergic transporters and receptors, because this is one of the most important neurotransmitters involved in ejaculatory functioning. Then there are dopamine, oxytocin, opioid, neurokinin-1, and glutamate. All these receptors involve a different level of ejaculatory mechanism, and different interventions have been proposed, but not all of them, as I told, are in clinical use of now. Then there are certain peripheral nervous system targets, alpha 1 adrenoreceptors, phosphodiesterase, enzyme system, Rho kinase, purinergic receptors, and pineal sensory nerve. So based on these potential targets, what are the treatment options? So what is the general broad algorithm for management of premature ejaculation with the available clinical treatments which we have? This is taken from Indian Psychiatric Society guidelines for management of premature ejaculation. Diagnosis is obviously based mostly on sexual history. We do evaluation to rule out other physical disorders and other sexual comorbidities, and most common comorbidities in Indian population across studies, as I already told, that was found in our study also, are erectile dysfunction and Dart syndrome. If these comorbidities are present, the guideline says that we need to treat these disorders first, or these disorders need to be primary focus of management rather than PMA. It has been noted that if PMA is happening due to erectile dysfunction, if you treat erectile dysfunction, or it is related to Dart syndrome, then the PMA is likely to resolve by itself. If it is no comorbidity, then look for presence of couple disharmony, depression, anxiety, and situational factor. This guideline takes into account that what are the factors that needs primary management rather than, and so gives us a sequential approach. So looking for these comorbidities, if these are present, so obviously treat marital disharmony before initiating any pharmacological behavioral management, or at least sometimes it is not always possible to solve these issues completely. Parental disharmony, as we all can understand, that cannot be solved all the time sufficiently. So at least that need to be taken into account before initiating management. And if there are comorbidities, treat psychiatric comorbidity first. Then obviously treatment is discussed with the therapist and client, and we take an informed decision when discussing treatment options with patient and partner and efficacy of each treatment options. As we need to understand that efficacy of available treatment options for PME might not be very high, and patient satisfaction factor with each treatment options is not 100%. So efficacy need to be told in earlier. There are pharmacological treatment options which I will be talking in detail, and there are non-pharmacological options, most of which I will be touching upon in this presentation. And if one of these approach fails, then there is combination of both approach. So treating underlying cause, then behavioral intervention, pharmacological or surgical intervention based on the need, and which options, this is dependent on type of PME classification, side effect profile of the treatment which we are going to offer, comorbidities and cost effectiveness. So first we'll discuss about behavioral management options. Nowadays therapies involve combination of behavioral and cognitive therapies. It is not about only controlling ejaculation by these therapies. It also includes the meaning of symptoms and context in nature in which it occurs. What does that mean? That means that in lot of patients who come for sexual dysfunction, actually the case is due to certain other factors that need to be looked for and that to be managed. So they might come as case of sexual dysfunction, but there are certain other issues that are more important and primary than sexual disorders. And how it improves PME, that identified techniques to control and delay ejaculation, improving confidence in sexual performance, lessening performance anxiety, modifying rigid sexual repertoire, surmounting barriers to intimacy, resolving interpersonal issues, increasing communication. Come to term is feeling thought that interfere with sexual function, and they are one of the important factors for performance and anxiety. As for the four subtypes, it has been discussed lifelong PME, because idiopathological theories says that lifelong PME is primarily occurring due to dysfunction in nervous system or neurotransmitter level dysfunction. So first line therapy in lifelong PME is pharmacotherapy. Lifelong PME cannot be improved only by behavioral management. The first line therapy is pharmacotherapy. Behavioral management can be included along with pharmacotherapy. Acquired PME, the most reason to find out the reason obviously, and then combination of psychological intervention in combination with pharmacotherapy. Variable PME, mostly psychoeducation, and PME, lack ejaculation, psychoeducation and psychological intervention obviously. So this first type and second type involve pharmacotherapy, and these two types mostly does not involve any kind of pharmacotherapy. So there are two specific behavioral interventions reported in, and used as of now. The first is a stop-start technique developed by James Seaman, and this technique is relatively more tolerated and have relatively more acceptance and satisfaction by clients. So how exactly this technique is offered? There are small variations reported in different textbooks and different papers. But this is from the original James Seaman technique, that he reported that stop-start technique with patient start doing it alone rather than with the partner. Like masturbating alone, doing it with a dry hand. So to reduce sexual excitement alone to the point of ejaculation. So So there is a point that is known as ejaculatory inevitability. What does that mean? That beyond that point, the person cannot further stop ejaculation. So person is taught to learn the point of ejaculatory inevitability, and once the person is able to understand, then he stops masturbation or self-stimulation before that point, stopping them, doing it at least 3 times or 4 times, the person can ejaculate. Once the person has mastered this to a certain extent, then repeated sessions for this thing, then increasing stimulation using lubrication, one can ask one's partner to masturbate, and then the same thing with the couple. And it is said that consistent practice of few weeks usually it is able to improve IELT 2 to 3 times. The second technique is the squeeze technique developed by Marshall and Johnson. This technique is about if man senses that he is about to experience premature ejaculation, that is the point of ejaculatory inevitability, he has to interrupt sexual relationship, man or preferably his partner, squeezes the shaft of penis between thumb and 2 fingers, applying the gentle pressure, I mean so that where the pressure has to be applied. This technique can be repeated as often as necessary, usually 3 to 4 times in one's intercourse. When this technique is successful, this improves the person's ability to control ejaculation and one's sense of satisfaction. However, as I reported earlier, this technique in comparison to stop-start technique is less preferably accepted and satisfaction rates are relatively lesser in comparison to stop-start technique. There are 2 points of pressure has been reported in the literature. One is at the just below the top of the penis, like applying pressure thumb at the base and 3 fingers on the dorsal side. Another side is applying pressure on the base of the penis. So there is no evidences in literature that which one is better. But I, in my clinical practice, has found that the applying pressure to the base is usually more accepted and basically more comfortable. There is another non-specific behavioral intervention that is able to help many of the patients, both in premature ejaculation and erectile dysfunction, is physical exercise developed by Abbott Teaser. Patient is trained to identify his pubococcygeal muscles, also known as pelvic muscles. The muscles can be simply identified by trying to stop urination in between. Then the exercise is to strengthen the pubococcygeal muscle. For this, the person is asked to clench this pubococcygeal muscle for around 3 seconds and release it for 10, and 10 sets of this exercise for 6 to 8 weeks is shown to improve ejaculatory time as well as also it's shown to improve erectile functioning. Then pharmacological intervention. These form one of the main set of intervention for treatment of premature ejaculation as of now. The most mainstay of treatment as of now is oral drugs followed by topical management. There are certain invasive procedures and what is about to come in future will be just talking. The first line therapy in PME is SSRI now. The important thing that to be kept in mind is it is chronic administration of SSRI. It is not SOS administration of SSRI that is going to help except decoxetine. It is chronic administration that prolongs the increases in synaptic class serotonin which desensitizes the 5-HT1A, 5-HT1B receptor. SSRI must be given for at least 1 to 2 weeks for being effective in PE. It does not start showing effect most of the time. Based on meta-analysis, among the comparison of different drugs, paroxetine is found to be superior than other available molecules like paroxetine, bupropion, sertraline. There were no significant relationship between dose and response among various drugs. So, what does this mean? That in one particular person, in different people, dose-response relationship are not well established. So, start with less dose. But if the person is not improving, the dose can be increased to the highest tolerable dose in that particular person. And one important thing that when we prescribe SSRI to the patient with PME, one of the major concerns to us is that it is likely to cause some other sexual dysfunction. We are treating PME and the person start reporting ED. But at least some of the evidence shows that sexual side effects like ED and reject reduce ejaculatory volume, which are more commonly reported in patients with depressive anxiety disorder, are relatively less common in patients only presenting with PME, those who do not have other depressive and anxiety disorder. And this has to be possibly related to the neurological dysfunctions associated present in the person. A subgroup of patients, specifically lifelong type, they do not respond to SSRI. If you do go in detail of neuropathological understanding, serotonergic modulation is variable and may be absent in that particular person. So, and serotonergic genetic polymorphism has been reported in that particular case. So, as of now, the treatment options that are available for such kind of clients is combining treatment, preferably SSRI with topical management, which I will be discussing. There is one approach that is very rapidly developing in such kind of patient is combining SSRI with 5-HT receptor antagonist. 5-HT receptor antagonists that are being developed for PME are not effective themselves in PME, but if they are combined with SSRI, they start showing the response. Then duboxetine, we all know, is specifically used SSRI for PME. It is used on on-demand basis. In RCT, 30 to 60 milligram, 1 to 2 hours before intercourse was effective from the first dose. So it does not require chronic administration and it starts showing response from the first dose. It improves ILT and ejaculatory control and decreases distress and increases satisfaction. Efficacy is found to be similar both in lifelong and acquired type, and treatment side effects are usually dose dependent, and as we can understand with all SSRI, it is nausea, diarrhea, headache and dizziness. And it can be co-administered with PDE5 inhibitor because as we have discussed, ED is one of the most common comorbidity in patients presenting with PME. And sometimes in recalcitrant PME, where the person is not responding to SSRI alone, PDE5 inhibitor is prescribed with duboxetine or SSRI even in absence of erectile dysfunction, and this has been shown to improve ejaculatory response at least in few patients. Then trometrom is another molecule, either although it causes more side effect, but in some studies it has been shown that the patient who are not responding to other SSRI might respond to trometrom. The usual doses recommended for PME are 25 to 75 milligram. Then the molecule which is which is being used for PME is tramadol. It is a centrally acting synthetic opioid analgesic. Mode of action is binding of parent compound and M1 metabolite to mu receptors and weak inhibition of reuptake of norepinephrine and serotonin. It is used as on demand basis and doses are usually 25 to 50 milligram. They can usually at least 2 hours before intercourse. Short term tolerability is good. Use of tramadol in PME rings a bell in mind of all of us that there can be potential for abuse, drug dependence and other side effects. But let me tell you that there are no long term studies. The studies are short term, funded by the drug developer, and in those short term studies, short term tolerability was good and it does not so increase the risk of abuse or drug dependence. So, but as a clinician, we have to choose the molecule in appropriate patient where the possibility of dependent or abuse potential is otherwise less. Then PDE5 inhibitor, their primary mode of treatment in erectile dysfunction. However, as we discussed earlier, in difficult to treat cases, addition of PDE5 inhibitor with SSRI may benefit certain other patients. अल्फा वन एंड्रो रिसेप्टर एंटागोनिस्ट दे हैज बीन डिस्कस्ड इन द अर्लियर लेक्चर इजैकुलेशन इज प्राइमरली सिंपैथेटिक स्पाइनल कॉर्ड रिफ्लेक्स सो दिस मेडिकेशंस हैज बीन रिसर्च्ड इन दिस ग्रुप टेराजोसिन एल्फ्यूजोसिन एंड सिलोडोसिन आर द मॉलिक्यूल व्हिच हैज बीन स्टडीड एंड सिलोडोसिन इज रिलेटिवली रीसेंट मॉलिक्यूल एंड हैज सम एट लीस्ट टू गुड स्टडीज टू सपोर्ट इट्स यूज इन प्रीमैच्योर Adrenergic blockage for premature ejaculation aims to decrease sympathetic tone of seminal tract and therefore delay ejaculation. It was also earlier tried as male contraceptive pill. However, it was failed and the failure rate was very high, so it was not continued. So the common side effect that we have to remember that it causes ejaculation, reduced semen volume, and orgasmic discomfort. So it might be chosen in the patient who has who does not have a need for a child or their family is completed. So it can be selected in those kind of patients. Serodosin is specifically found to be useful for the patient who have additional lower urinary tract symptom. That means symptom that we commonly associate with BPH, hesitancy, urge, incontinence. So if the patient is presenting with LUTS with PME, serodosin may be a preferred molecule rather than SSRI. Topical agent, these are one of the most earliest known treatment for PME. Hypothesis is they cause benign hypothesis that PME is due to benign hypersensitivity. So these molecules are going to be helpful. A recent meta-analysis completed just 3 years back included 8 trials and it shows that involves significant improvement in comparison to placebo. It is applied to penis 20 to 30 minutes prior to intercourse and it is recommended to wash off before sex. Prolonged application of topical anesthesia beyond 30 minutes might result in loss of erection due to numbness of penis. So it is advised that loss of after 20-30 minutes and in many patients condom might not be required if they
Okay, fine. Over to you.
Yeah, good morning. As soon as I got down from the airport, I got a call from other Tripathi saying that, boss, we require run rate. You are the hard dick Pandya. So you have to come and increase the run rate. So I'm here. I thank the organizers to invite me for this program. There is some technical glitch. We will be able to solve it and we'll start the presentation. So my focus is on medico-legal aspects of potency test. And of course the previous session was so wonderful and also the prevalence of male sexual dysfunction is so high, there were so many questions that indicates. Now we will move into the medico-legal aspects. So before I start, there is a disclaimer. Basically, I will be giving some examples. Don't take it personally, it is not your case. It is somebody else, and also some of the videos or the photographs are very explicit. It is for the academic purpose, not for any other purpose. Dr. Satyanarayan Rao is smiling at me. I'll be using some of the videos. So this is the presentation. First, what is impotence? This is the definition as given by various legal fraternity. One is Supreme Court and High Court. See, this marriage, divorce, and various issues, this definition of potency and impotency has been defined by various courts. The Supreme Court has defined as impotence as a party must be held to be important in his life or mental and physical condition makes consummation of marriage impossible. This is the definition given by the Supreme Court. But however, next to the Delhi High Court, which slightly altered it, lack of ability to perform full and complete sexual intercourse. This is the definition given by the Delhi High Court. But however, the definition changes from state to state depending upon the cases rendered. Now coming to this legal definition again, this is gender neutral because as per the importance what we look at as clinically is usually the male. But however, the law says that even a female can be impotent. That's the way it has been considered. And also various countries also talks about female impotency, and there are various tests. But today I'll be focusing only on the male impotence test. So again, a party is impotent if his or her, the word is or her, is the condition. That's the way the law takes it. It need not be male, it can be female also. And also the incapacity to perform sexual intercourse is one of the criteria they have kept, but need not be complete impotence. The issue here is there may be physiological reason, maybe weakness or psychological reason which can cause impotence. That is how it has been considered, and inability to copulate is the one word which has been coined by various other courts and they have used it. But however, the clinical definition is very clear. It's a male is said to be impotent when there is inability to develop or maintain a penile erection sufficient to conclude the act of intercourse. Again, orgasm and ejaculation has been considered. Now we will move, these are the various legal definitions, but now coming to the potency test. What is potency test? There are various potency tests have been named by various courts, and in various countries there are various tests have been given. I have listed some of the tests, and in our country there is hardly 3 or 4 tests are used for forensic purpose. First and the foremost is blood test. They are using it for basically to know whether any pathology is there, whether the person cannot perform. So it includes RBS, or maybe you can call it as diabetes, sexual hormones, lipid profile, thyroid hormones, FSH, and the PAT test. This is one of the commonest. They are using it nowadays. And another one is duplex, ultrasonography or penile Doppler scan. The rest are very rarely used, but however, worth mentioning because of the academic issue. So these are the various testings have been used, but however, I would not like to talk to them because we hardly use in the legal arena. The most other three important is semen analysis. This is one of the court, the high courts talked about potency test and semen analysis. It was highly criticized because potency cannot be compared to fertility. That was the issue which has been discussed. And the next one is visual erection examination, which is commonly done in India, and the gold standard. The fellow was impotent and she goes for divorce, saying that separation, the marriage never occurred, and she's able to prove that yes, the annulment will be given and the marriage never occurred. The second one is the marriage has occurred, later she goes to the court after more than 1 year, then the divorce will be granted. But again she has to prove that it was, that he could not have a rigid erection to perform sexual intercourse, then the divorce will be granted. But if it is present at both the time, then the annulment will be given. So there are various cases again about this. Now the burden of proof, who has to prove this? The person who accuses the other person has to prove it. If the lady accuses the husband, she has to prove it. What is the way of proving? Going to the doctor, consultation document. If the lady says, I have not been consummated in the marriage, and she is able to prove that she is virgin, now the onus is on the husband to prove that he is having erection. That is, potency is there. So this has a very, what we call it as, any lady can say that yes, my husband is impotent, and she can go to the court. But however, the prima facie has to be there to the court, yes, this lady has some substantiate telling that yes, there is impotency. But however, if there is any abortion or else there was a child issue, then they will not ask for potency test for the husband. So there is another clause which comes as relative impotence. What is this? It's basically a person can be impotent to a lady, but he may be able to have sexual intercourse with another lady, normally. That means to a specific person he is impotent, but not to another person. So in such cases also, again, the divorce will be granted. But the other issue which is very common in India, which is around 4 to 5%, is non-consummation of the marriage. Even after 6 months, 1 year, the lady continues to be virgin, the husband is unable to perform, or the lady is refusing to have sexual intercourse because of various reasons. And the reasons may be psychological or physical reasons or many other reasons may be there. But however, the non-consummation marriage cannot be a reason for annulment of the marriage. It has to be non-consummation plus impotence, then only annulment. But however, if the lady continues to refuse for sex, or then it has to, that will be considered as a cruelty in marriage and the divorce will be granted, not the annulment. Because the difference between annulment and divorce is annulment, the marriage never occurred, the lady will not get any benefit. Like there are many cases which has happened is, since you know when there is a divorce or any case is pending in the court of law, it will take 10 years or 12 years, by the time the man naturally becomes impotent. Because of that, what they did was, husband and wife decides, they will go to the court and say, I am impotent. The lady also says he is impotent, marriage never occurred. They sent, it is granted very early. But these cases slightly started increasing in Mumbai. Then the issue came up, should we allow this or not? But the issue was, if he marries again, by chance, for example, I take divorce, from, annulment I take from my wife, and I am impotent, but the next marriage is again invalid. So, the marriage will never be valid. That means, if somebody is proved impotent in the court of law, the next marriage also remains invalid. So that issue, many of these male forgot. And the next lady who gets married anytime, she can claim that he is impotent. And she can walk away from the marriage. But however, the male will have the liberty of not giving his property to her because marriage never happened. So this issue which has come up, but again, there are various courts have given various definitions. The other issue also came is false allegation of impotence. Like in the court of law, the lady goes and claims that my husband is impotent or he is unable to satisfy me, but the husband is able to prove that he is potent. That can be a ground for divorce, considering as cruel. And in many cases, the High Court has, the district court has said, no, 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 this cannot be. But the High Court has clearly said that now we will give grant divorce in such a situation because it harms the personhood of a person. That's how it has been considered. Now, if the lady says that the husband has to undergo potency test, if the person says, I don't want to undergo, this is my fundamental right, how can the court force me to undergo test? Again, the Supreme Court in various cases, it has said that the family court has all, by the virtue of section 12 of the Family Court Act, it can ask or force somebody to undergo potency test. But however, if he issues an order, still he continues to refuse to undergo test, then the adversarial inference will be taken. That means the case will go against him. That's how the various cases have been decided. Again, in the Supreme Court view, so the matrimonial court can, what is that, force somebody to undergo test, similar to what we had brain mapping test which was done against the accused will, or else even if we call it as narco analysis which we used to do, has been again the consent has to be taken. Similarly here also, though the court can order, but the consent of the person has to be taken, but if he refuses, the inference will be against him. Next came the constitutional validity. Some of them even questioned it. It is against the man. The lady will say that he is impotent and the man has to undergo all these tests. But again, the court said that in such situation where we don't have any answer, it has to undergo test. The person has to undergo test. This is how, and it also says that it does not infringe the fundamental rights of a person. Because they said Article 21, right to life and liberty. How can you force me? That was the question raised. But however, the Supreme Court said no. Coming to, this is about the civil cases, coming to the criminal cases, this is the just because majority of this potency test is useful in civil cases. Now in the criminal cases, we will discuss whether it is useful or not. Even in various countries, the potency test has been already been removed in the definition of rape or the assault. Why? Immediately after the Nirbhaya case in Delhi, there has been amendment for section 375. Many of us know and many of us we do not know. The comprehensive definition, usually the rape occurs within the four walls or in a solitary places. And if you say that a person who has raped will be given death sentence or hanging, what he will do after committing rape? He will kill her or he will kill the child. Because the child or the woman is the evidence who is going to tell in the court of law. For that reason, they said, no, we will withhold it. We can't go for the higher punishment because we will lose the victim or the survivor also. That was the issue. But however, the issue of chemical castration is still debated, but we don't know. It may come in. Coming to this, the Verma committee has come up with the expanded definition of rape. It talks about bodily integrity of the woman. Nobody can touch a woman. It can be constituted as a rape. The autonomy is takes the precedence here. What are the amendments which has occurred in section 375? These are the various. It doesn't talk about basically penetration of penis and vagina. It also says mouth, ureter, urethra, anus of a woman, or making her to do with him or with another person. It need not be penis. It can be an object. Any object or a part of the body, not being the penis into the vagina, urethra, anus again. Second. Third, asking or forcing a lady to do on her own, manipulating her, any part of the body of a woman, so to ask to cause penetration into the vagina, urethra, anus, again, all these things, applying his mouth on the vagina or anus, various. So now it's nothing to do with just penis and vagina. The comprehensive change has occurred in the definition of rape. It is section 375. Now it has taken a huge leap, which occurred in 2013. It also has been seen in POXO Act also. Again, rape definition to concise. It is not mere penile and vaginal contact. No scope. The scope now, the scope has been widened. No need of erection, because he can put a finger in a lady's vagina. It can be considered as a rape. No need of penis, object, oral sex can constitute rape, making one person to do on another person, making a person to do on herself. So these are the things which goes against the potency test. Even in the POXO Act, if you look at it, it is a general, gender neutral, which has various, again it doesn't talk about rape, even in POXO Act, it talks about penetrative sexual act, or what you call it as aggravated penetrative sex. And these are the notable people who underwent POXO, sorry, testing of potency test. The reason being is the law was amended, but the medical science did not progress with the law at that time, and unfortunately they have been tested. Example I can give you, imagine a person who is potent, he has a sildenafil citrate, wants to rape, he will rape, and then after 1 or 2 days he says, I am impotent. So issues. Unfortunately, the police have not been educated. Forget about police. Many of our medical fraternity are not aware there is a section 375 has been amended. Still they think rape means genital contact has to be there. But the police will bring them and ask for potency test in almost all rape accused cases. And forcing all the accused to take this test. Yes, you can force it, but the problem is, if the potency test comes negative, you will say, I have not done it. That's the biggest problem. And again, if you take the current potency test across the world, it is not foolproof. It can merely say that there was erection or not. It cannot say the rape occurred or not. And finally, how to issue a certificate? The certificate, please never individually issue a certificate. The medical board has to be formed, and the certificate will not talk about the rape. The rape occurred or not, because rape is a legal term, and the term has now widened the scope. Earlier it was used to say that the person against the consent has done the intercourse. That is not there now. So your summary of your certificate should be, after examining Mr. So-and-so, son of so-and-so, ID mark, date of examination or dates of examination, you would have undergone examination 1 or 2 or 3 nights. It can be opined that there is nothing suggest that Mr. So-and-so is incapable to perform sexual intercourse as on date of examination. Because he would have committed a crime on some day, and he will come for examination after 3 months. After 3 months, when you do the examination, he may be potent or he may be impotent, we don't know at that time. So you can actually say that on the day of examination whether he was potent or impotent. That's how you are going to issue the certificate. And to conclude, potency test in civil case has a role in divorce or annul, those kind of things, but in criminal case it doesn't have any role at this point of time. Though many of the forensic medicine people, few of them argue that yes, in rape cases, in certain cases it can be used, but if you look at the literature and as the day passes, we may give away with potency test. So this is my the last slide. Thank you very much.
So I think wonderfully presented, very lucid, very, very to the point. And it's a big social burning problem. A lot of issues involved, and we as intellectuals, not just as psychiatrists, we as intellectuals, I think we should know a whole lot of the things. So I would request the audience to please utilize this expert who has come for you. And already I see the name, I already see Professor Vayan Bahia. Yes, your comments please, thank you. And the session is open to the audience.
Am I permitted to quote a case?
Yes, sir.
Right, so this is this 58-year-old gentleman whose wife complained that she had not, it's one of the stunning cheap cases that will work out, please, but it's a serious issue. So the 58-year-old gentleman who had not been able to have sex with his wife for the past 3 years, he was investigated and advised by sildenafil. On a particular Saturday afternoon, without telling his wife, when she went out shopping, he took the sildenafil and got completely charged, waiting for the wife to return in the promised half hour. She called up to say that a friend had, she had met up with a school friend and she was going for a movie and she was not going to be back for 4 hours. So he phoned up his andrologist. He said, sir, this works wonders. I took sildenafil and I'm all charged, but the wife isn't coming back for 4 hours. What do I do? He said, well, 4 hours, it will wear off, but if you can use your new achievement somewhere else, right? Is there someone around? He said, yeah, the maid is in the house. He said, ask her. He said, but sir, with my maid, I don't need sildenafil. What's the medical legal status? Proof importance. All tests done. Sildenafil advice. And now it becomes a situational importance. What do you do?
You're asking legal question or a comment service?
I'm asking a serious question. Because what do we do? This is a true story. I'm not generating one. It's not a WhatsApp joke. It's a true story.
I respect your comments, sir. The question also, see, for this reason, the issue of relative impotency came, so that is the reason adultery has been removed now for criminal punishment. If he has a sex with his maid, so obviously it's a ground for divorce. Earlier, he used to be punished for, I think, 6 or 7 years of imprisonment. So the court has said that, okay, this relative impotence may be there or something else reason. So the adultery has now been removed from, I think 2 years back or 2 or 3 years back, it has been removed from the, what we call it as criminal punishment. But however, civil, the divorce will be granted. But however, the morality continues to be there, sir. Yes, I agree with you. Oh, wife is not there, but unfortunately has taken sildenafil citrate, which will wear off in another 1 or 2 hours, but he cannot wait. He wants to use the sildenafil citrate, but yes, he will have either the divorce will be in the corner if she wife comes to him.
What about the issue of the maid putting a charge of rape?
Yeah,
and the person saying that I'm impotent.
This is where, again, now coming back to this, sir. Tell them if the wife, see, the maid is given a consent, fine. If the maid says no, then it's a rape, clearly. And if he says that I'm impotent and he shows all those things, yes, there is a possibility. But the definition of rape has changed now. He need not have erection to commit rape now. Even oral sex is constituted as a rape. So the rape charges will be charged against him because the consent is not taken. Yes, sir. Sir,
this is also regarding a case.
Mike, the audience.
This is also regarding a case. And I am not, you are not supposed to make any judgment. I am also not a deposit substitute even now. Very tricky issue. One gentleman, a healthy adult. And this gentleman already married. He is married a doctor, Paikan Basu. But he has an affair with a bar lady at Rama. And he has got a child. He has already married for the daughter. Now, the lady had, this bar lady had given trouble, is in the court. He has never disclosed that he is married earlier. And he has promised that he will marry me. And now he says that I don't want to marry. Will it come under the post of rape? He has got a child, number one. Number two, she has told her, why don't we do a DNA test? He said, no, I don't, his certificate says no, 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 DNA test. But all these cases, it is probably that if the police officer asks, you have to do it, DNA test. It is still in the court. Very tricky issue, but fortunately the first wife, doctor, because of her wisdom, she deserted him, legal divorce. Legal divorce. So he has got a child in this lady. Now the case is over. Very tricky issue, but the boy is highly politically influential, and so much money is there, then he can hire any advocate. This is the issue. But can you just make your academic comment?
Yeah, it's
not legal.
As an academic comment, it's difficult to come here, but legally I can speak, academic legal points I can bring.
Yeah,
this case, what you said also is very common. Imagine a unmarried guy and unmarried girl. They fall in love with each other. They engage in sex thinking that the girl thinks that he will marry me. And later he says, no, I don't want to marry. Now this girl goes to the police station and says, the consent which was taken was coerced. Why? What is the coercion? Marriage preposition was given to me, so I agreed to sleep with him. Now he is refusing to sleep with or marry him.
I will add to that, even in the child's birth certificate, even the schooling, the father's name was his name, and he has done it. And at least 3-4 years, he has even paid money for him to stay there with all the receipts and the child is also the father of the school. He has even signed.
Actually, sir, in this way, even in Bollywood, recently there was a case where a hero...
No, this is a true story.
I think that one will be able to tell about the case. In that case also, the court has given the bail. The bail was rejected earlier. Now the bail has been given because there was an issue of they had a very good, what we call it as, cohabitation, staying under the same roof, had many times intercourse, and then after some days she realizes he is getting engaged to somebody else. She goes and gives a rape case. So he was arrested. It was Me Too campaign was occurring at the same time. He was the other person said that Me Too is not for only women, for men also. So that came and the Supreme Court has recently given him the bail. And he is now out after I think 35 days of imprisonment. He was there, he's come out. But again, here also the concern, the issue of consent as a coerced consent is a very difficult preposition. But however, many cases have been, the rape charges have been dropped because the issue here is the consent taken during the, what we call it as the physical. One is the issue, but the other issue also has come is what they call it as, especially in US, UK, the lady says that you can have a foreplay, not the rape, sorry, sexual intercourse. We will have a foreplay, we will enjoy kissing, but the person goes ahead, at some time she says no. Should he, no, no, we have foreplay, we will have intercourse. But she says no. Does it constitute a rape? Yes. She can withdraw consent at any time. This was again one of the case where the lady went to the room of a person's and everything was done, initially foreplay, but later she said no. For that no.
Does it come under rape?
Yes, this case was considered as a rape and he has been charged, and the case is, I think they have lost the case in the district court, in the high court, it is pending in the Supreme Court, because he said that there was a foreplay, she had given a consent, she gave, he shows the register of the apartment she has entered, and what is the CCTV shows that he goes with him, and later when she comes out after I think around 6 or 7 hours down the line, she comes out of the room crying. But the issue was this, earlier she gave the consent, but later she has withdrawn the consent. That issue has come up, and then they said it's rape. So this issue of consent is one which is very essential, rather than it's just a genital contact.
Mic for Dr. Yanin, please. Yes. In my city, a case filed a female on the size of the penis. My partner has a short size penis, so I want to take divorce.
Yeah. Fair. Yeah, right, sir. Definitely. This issue has been not only with the male, the woman saying that I have not been satisfied with my husband, or the man saying that my wife doesn't give satisfaction, is not a ground for divorce. Yeah. If he is able to prove, that's the reason I told you. In civil cases, this potency test plays a very important role. But in criminal cases, no. It says that even a small erection, or what we call it as, they say around the register 25 to 30%, is more than enough under the testing scrutiny that he is able to perform a normal sexual intercourse. So in that situation, even small penis or mild virginity cannot be a ground for divorce.
What will be the legal side?
What will be the legal side of the penis for sir?
The Supreme Court has not done any studies, sir. So, there is not such thing, because I think in the previous presentation, Dr. Adar started with a connotation. It is not the size, sir. It is the activity which matters. So, if the size may be big and it is inactive, what is the use? It's if you, somebody said, is it the cat or the mouse? The mouse which creates a walk in the hall, the cat may go quietly outside.
Yes.
Yeah. Which is the most commonly accepted test in the court for?
Yeah, the court, the issue here is the court will accept any test. If the issue here is the lawyer which he questions, why you have not done ABCD? Usually they take only three testing they will consider. One is all blood test, including sexual transmitted diseases, they are not taking it. For other reasons, why we don't know. There's some of them, some I think in UP they continues to have that semen analysis. It doesn't relate to potency. The third one is visual examination. Fourth one is Doppler. Fifth one is Regiscan if it is available. These are the five things they say, and the court is happy with the doctor's opinion or the medical board opinion. These are the five tests usually taken. So one is blood test, including semen analysis, that is two. The third one is Doppler. Fourth one, Regiscan, and other is visual examination. What they say is visual examination, is there any physical deformity which impairs his, what we call it as, erection. That is all. These are the five tests they have taken. Many district hospitals do not have. It is left to the, if they take it to a bigger hospital, SDPGI, AIMS. AIMS does many tests. AIMS standard cannot be put in the district hospital, because otherwise, imagine AIMS comes up with the list of all tests what I showed. Tomorrow the advocate defending that, you say you have not done all these things. And you walk away. And one, your test is not complete.
Thank you. You can continue with it. One last.
The life you told
last
is a ground for divorce.
After that, we have
what about sterility? Sterility means if the person is unable to conceive.
Fertility or sterility is not a ground for divorce or another marriage. It's very clearly, many times it has said, otherwise many men would have married many times, not just having a male baby. Forget about having a child, five female, but I want a male, I want to marry another one. So that's the issue. So sterility or these issues are not considered as a ground for divorce.
Last question of this session, and we welcome to President S.S. Rao, the sexual man.
The institution himself.
Congratulations for the presentation. Regarding the potency test which people have raised,
all the tests what we do, they have limitations. And ultimately, there are quite a few examples are there. What woman says is going to be
better than that.
So, these are all the tests to establish certain things because she's a perfect lawyer and the same lawyer that we have. And of course, there are certain situations where the group will have to examine it automatically, he is going to handle it. But with all the things, a woman can try to make it through, but she has not actually. Whether she is a virgin, she now it's almost impossible to establish that she is a virgin or not. So, but actually I have been told even by some of the legal experts also that the word of this lady is actually the ultimate sacrosanct comment of the legal experts.
And sir, and also the wordings we use in the certificate is also it's a negative. If we don't say that he has potential, we say there are nothing which impairs his ability.
People have done a lot of tests. For example, Rasaram Babu, when this particular complaint came and he was there in the cell one of the days, they had brought some ladies to see that they stimulated the investigation. So, Zirav tried for
the test. Imagine, sir, the police goes and touch AVRX. <areas. laughs>
So,
for female, it doesn't
pass. Then actually, for quite some time, and now, of course, things have improved. But all said, of course,
so in one of the rape or accused case, as you said sir, they did test, but when the male attender went inside to remove everything, he got erection because he was homosexual. So these things do happen, sir.
Well, talking about erection, we can stand up for you. Huh? thank you very much. Very stimulating discussion also from the audience. We thank the audience greatly. And I think your questions will continue over lunch also. Thank you all.
Thank you, Professor Suresh and the chairperson. May I now invite Dr. Vipul Tyagi, is he here?
नमस्ते, मेरा नाम डॉक्टर विहंग वहिया, मैं बम्बई का मनोचिकित्सक हूँ और आज यहाँ लखनऊ में जातीय संबंधों से मिलीजुली शिकायतों के बारे में या स्वास्थ्य के बारे में चर्चा करने के लिए हमें यहाँ बुलाया गया है। आम तौर पे जातीय संबंध हर एक इंसान के जीवन में बहुत महत्व रखते हैं, मगर एक सादी क्रिया जातीय संबंधों की, उससे कई सारी अलग अलग बातें जुड़ी हुई है, जिसके कारण कई युवान पीड़ी के लोग पीड़ित रहते हैं, गलत फहमियों से मसले रहते हैं और परेशानी महसूस करते हैं। इनसे मेरा एक ही संदेशा है कि जातीय संबंधों की भावना होना और जातीय संबंध करने की ख्वाहिश होना ये आम बात है। आम तौर पे सजातीय संबंधों के बारे में सामाजिक मूल्यों की गणना अलग होती है। आम तौर पर समाज ये अपेक्षा करती है कि जातीय संबंध पर अलग ऑपोजिट सेक्स के साथ होने चाहिए, सजाति नहीं पर जाति के साथ होने चाहिए, मगर कई लोगों में समजातीय संबंध भी होते हैं और इसके बारे में यदि व्यक्ति अपने तरफ से उनको परेशानी ना हो तो उसमें कोई बाधा या उसके ऊपर कोई वैद्यकीय रोग का निदान नहीं होता, मगर यदि अपनी जातीय संबंधों की प्रथा से कोई भी व्यक्ति पीड़ित हो तो उसका समझबूझ से इलाज हो सकता है। हालांकि उसके लिए कोई दवाइयां इस वक्त उपलब्ध नहीं है। खुले मन से बात करना, मनोचिकित्सक के पास जाना, अपने मन की व्यथा खुले दिल से बताना और अपने ही मन से, अपने ही काबिलियत से अपनी ज़िंदगी में दुख हटा के सुख पैदा करना हर इंसान के लिए संभव है।
सर्टन रोल्स व्हिच आर सो कॉल्ड मैस्कुलिन और एफेमिनेट रोल्स एंड दीज आर सिंक्रोनाइज्ड विद द असाइंड सेक्स एंड देन देयर आर ट्रेडिशनल और एक्सपेक्टेड रोल्स व्हिच आर जनरली कॉल्ड नॉर्मल और स्ट्रेट इंडिविजुअल्स हु फिट इन टू द सोसाइटी एक्सेप्टेड जेंडर रोल्स आर कॉल्ड स्ट्रेट। So then what is the opposite of straight? People who do not follow the society accepted gender rules, are they twisted? We honestly don't know. But there is this LGBT community which is very sensitive about being called straight or not straight. And of course there is this one saying, oh please, don't call me, you know, go straight. It's LGBT. We as therapists, so please use terms which will not provoke a retaliation. And then there is sexual attraction for another person, maybe of the same gender, sex or opposite sex in gender. That is the sexuality of an individual. So developmentally, we talk of sexual identity, sexual role, gender identity and gender role. But of relevance today is the sexual orientation, which is irrespective of these four variables. So, what is the norm? Normally, we always talk of two sexes, male and female. We never talk of sexuality as specified. Ever since documented human history, it is presumed that males will be gynophilic, meaning heterosexual, and females will be androphilic, meaning heterosexual. But today, we are so open-minded, so philosophical, so accepting, that we are accepting the occurrence of something different. We have people whose sex and sexuality are not specified. So they are the androphilic or gynophilic, men and women. The obvious definition is that androphilic person has sexual attraction to men or masculinity and gynophilic person has sexual attraction to women or effeminity. So outcome is androphilic males who are homosexuals or gynophilic females who prefer to have sex with other women. Invariably then, there are these ambiphilic people who are bisexual, who have combination of both androphilia and gynophilia. The outcome then is that we are ambiphilic males and ambiphilic females. But there is a fly in the ointment. We are intersex. People whose, it is a general terminology for people whose genitalia do not fall into the typical male or female genitalia. And these people then complicate the issue with gynophilic intersex, androphilic intersex, or intersex who do not indulge in sexual activity. So, today, ignore this woman, she talks too much, so I've silenced her. But what she has actually said is that we have to explore relationship assigned and the sexual orientation. What is the relationship between the assigned sex and orientation? And hence the term androphilia, gynephilia and amphiphilia are preferred over the traditional terms of homosexual, heterosexual or bisexual. So when we talk of sexual orientation, irrespective of genitalia and preferences, it's the orientation which are, this is behavioral science term, describes sexual orientation. It's an alternative to the binary yes or no classification of homosexual and heterosexual. Androphilics are sexually attracted to men and masculinity. Gynephilic are sexually attracted to women and affinity, irrespective of this burning issue of expected roles of assigned sex. This has nothing to do with the mythology or the religious beliefs or the ruling, whatever. Amphiphilia is a combination of androphilia and gynephilia, or the bisexuality. These are objective terms. They identify a person's focus and sexual attraction. This is without any attribution to assigned sex or gender identity. It avoids bias or confusion or criminal overtures of describing preferences. Objectively, it describes intersex and transgender whose gender may not be specified as male or female. In fact, this classification categorically authenticates the occurrence of amphiphilia. In this context, we talk of therapy or sex therapy. Normally, unless the person is positively with some insight, anxious or depressed, nobody wants a psychiatrist. Then you say, go for therapy. Why a psychiatrist? And then say, sex therapy. Oh my God, why me? Let's then talk of why, when, who, what, where and which of sex therapy. Why sex therapy? Sex therapy is a realization that gender, sexuality and sex are rather complex processes. They do not fall into established neurosciences. You do not have circuits that will tell you what is what. Traditionally, problems of sex and sexuality are clubbed with relationship issues. But all of us in this house would have realized that ever so often we see couples who are very well related with each other and come for specific sexual problems. So sex therapy in this situation is completely a talk therapy. There is no hands-on demonstration. There are attempts to resolve sex-related problems by specifically addressing them. There should be no presumptions and it should be based on clear statements about presenting problems. I cited that case of a 58-year-old gentleman who was all charged after taking sildenafil and said that he did not need sildenafil with his maid. So I called him. I said, what's going on? Tell me the truth. He said, sir, the last 3 years that I have not been having sex with my wife, I masturbate, and when I masturbate, I fantasize my maid. I've never had a physical contact with her. So there was no question of any of the legal issues. He just fantasized, and there is no law against fantasizing. So you have to have very clear data. And then, this is a form of psychotherapy by specialized therapies who are aware of sexuality, which is way beyond personal opinion, personal experiences or personal fantasies. It has to be objective. It offers sexological methods to treat sexual issues. And the strategy can be to improve sexual function in otherwise properly functioning couple or in a dysfunctioning couple. Long ago, when I was very fresh in psychiatry, there were cases where there was use of surrogate add-on sexual partners. This is not now a standard procedure legally or officially. It might be done under the wraps. Somebody said, what is sexological method? Well, I will talk about this when we talk of which of this sex therapy. Probably we have six W's. We started with the why, now we have when and who. So, when is it indicated? When there are dysfunctions, premature ejaculations, delayed ejaculation or erectile dysfunction, when there is lack of interest in sex, general pervasive lack of interest in sex. 1977, much before some of you were born, most of you were born, I started my practice. 2 months into my private practice and I get a phone from one of the Gulf consulates saying, Dr. Vahiya, do you practice sex? And I said, with great pleasure, I'm married, I can say this. He says, no. His Excellency Sheikh Abdullah, who's in Oberoi Hotel, Sankhera Suite, has sexual problem. So I go to meet this Sheikh Abdullah in Sankhera Suite of Oberoi Hotels. There were 25 Sheikh Abdullahs. It took me some time to figure out who's the Sheikh Abdullah that I needed to meet. So I walk into this room, there is this 40-year-old gentleman with three seemingly commercial sex workers behind him. All very happy. I couldn't speak Arabic then, I can't speak Arabic now, but I asked him, Sheikh, what problem? So he says, Doctor, no get up. I said, no get up? Then what are these three doing behind you? He said, Bombay, very good get up. How many times? 9 times. In how many days? 3 days. I said, wait a minute, who's treating whom? So you want to have a very clear picture and you got to know that this lack of sexual interest, confidential arousal is not situational and pervasive before we get into it as professionals. There would be cases of atypical sexual interest, gender dysphoria, painful sex, problems of being a transgender, high sex drive and hypersexuality, impulsive or compulsive sexual behavior, recovering from sexual assault, and problems of aging and illness and disability. People from Bombay, that one is here. There is recently a case where a 12-year-old boy tried to have, or 16-year-old boy tried to have sex with a 12-year-old girl, and then she started screaming and he pushed her off the 8th floor of the building and now she's just dying this morning. So, it's a whole issue of hypersexuality or disinhibited sexual behaviors. So, essentially, sex therapy takes care of the entire DSM-5 spectrum or the ICD-10 spectrum of what is described as sexual disorder. In each of this, where there is no drug therapy or no underlying psychopathology, sex therapy is indicated. So who's a sex therapist? Sex therapists, they come in multiple shapes and sizes. Psychiatrists, psychologists, marriage and family therapists, psychiatric social worker, medical social worker, trained nurses, Ayush physicians, I don't know, but they also have a lot of sexual medicine in their training period, I believe. And then there's a whole range of faith healers who pronounce themselves as sex therapists. We need to be careful. On the WhatsApp, there was this message. Pappu hilane wala. Hila lega shareer ka har ka wo ang. Jisne hilna kar diya ho ban. Very suggestive. But then I am a psychiatrist. I tried to call him up. And the number he has given is 9-digit number. You can't call him. You just love, that's all. So, when it comes to faith healers, we've got to be very cautious. I must tell you that there are some really educated people who do this faith healing and they send patients to psychotherapists, psychiatrists. I do get some references from some centers, but most of them are not reliable. So please ask your patient to stay away from there. A sex therapist is trained in specific methods of sex therapy beyond the minimal part of training. Just because we are an MBBS or a PhD or a psychologist, it's not enough. There are graduate schools in US and now in Karnataka, Dr. T.S.S. Rao, the Total Sex Solution Rao, has set up an institute. Is that right, Dr. Rao? Both, you agree with the definition of, the long form of T.S.S. and the rest of it. There are specific journals that what is the difference between seeking help on issues of sexual medicine from a sex therapist and a non-sex therapist. I equate this with advice from a consultant and an advice from a general practitioner. Or a neurophysician treating anxiety and depression versus a psychiatrist treating anxiety and depression. So, having talked of when and who, we now move to what. What is psychotherapy? Before we do when and when. Psychotherapy, sex therapy is a talk therapy imparted by specially trained therapists with complete undisputable professionalism. So, what is professionalism? No gossips, never discussing your cases over the kitty parties, never personalize, ritualize, moralize, socialize, trivialize, scandalize, and never be judgment about the topic of pain of sex-related issues. Before a couple comes to a therapist for sexual issue, the person would have suffered in silence for years. So please exhibit warmth without touching. Professionalism is the foremost. There are huge therapists will offer probable ways. Therapists, they will never say it's a one-to-one, this is your problem and that's the solution. Doesn't work in sex therapy. You explore what are the possible alternatives. Tailor the treatment to the patient's needs and expectations. Never be coercive and never be imposing. Maine bola na, kar lo. That's not the way you do it. You have to be able to persuade the person to accept the suggestion that you have offered after elaborate detailed study and experience of similar cases. Do not presume that when relationships work out, sex will fall in place. It doesn't. There has to be a proficiency in physiological processes and anatomy of human sexuality, including the current discussion on the neurocircuits of sexuality. Rule out any medical causes of sexual problem and be completely non-judgmental about sexual orientation and transgender existence. That's primary. We are not judges, we are psychiatrists. We have to inculcate a positive outlook on the beneficial influences of what sexuality disorders or treatment can have on patients' life in general. And awareness of sequelae of sexual problems. Not just marital conflicts, anxieties, depressions, various other problems that come up because of this. And we have to be scientific, meaning objective, and never ideological in what we say. So having said what is, where should it be performed? It should always, and which is sex therapy. Where is it administered? Always, always in the therapist's office. Never at the person's personal office, house. It has to be completely professional and you cannot have contacts beyond the clinic. It might be in a hospital, but clinic and never ever in the patient's house or a hotel. It's a form of counseling. And the first priority, sorry?
Sheikh Abdullah.
No, I didn't do anything. I just asked him who's pretty, whom, and I came back. After charging my fees. So, priority is to establish rapport. There has to be a good rapport. And the aim is to resolve just the sexual difficulties between the individuals and the couples. Don't get into problems of their personal life. The duration, it could be individual or coupled together. Duration will depend upon the presenting problems. Anticipate anxiety and inhibitions at the commencement of therapy. It's not easy for a person to talk of personal details. Inquire and explore general health, education, sexual experiences, beliefs and past beliefs, past experiences. Specify client's problems and expectations. No physical contact and stop when the client is uncomfortable. Sexuality, education, beyond, and what kind of homework? Begin with education. We said it's sexual identity, sexual role, gender identity, and gender role. Go in the reverse order. Clarify differences between gender identity, gender role, sexual identity, and sexual role to both the couples. So there was this 25-year-old married couple came to me when I was a resident for unconsummated sex, unconsummated marriage. I sat with the couple and we discussed, and I asked them about what they knew of sexuality. And the husband said, "Doctor, I am very intrigued." He was a bank manager and he was married to a wife who was matriculate working in the state corporation as the ticket vendor. So educated couple. Said, "What is the problem?" He said, "Doctor, we are not able to get through this major intrigue in our life." "So what's so intriguing about sexuality?" He said, "Doctor, she's got two apertures." In my mind, I said, "Wow, how lucky." Said, "There is one aperture where she urinates and the other aperture is where she menstruates, and I don't know where to put my organ in." This is an educated couple. We have to be able to deal with these issues. Address myths and misconceptions. There are plenty. Prakash Kodani can give you a 5-hour talk on it. Give homework. Recommend, but don't stop them from doing what they voluntarily want to do. Don't recommend. We are not agents for any of these toys or positions. Sense and focus, somebody brought this up. It begins, it's a technique for couples to build trust and intimacy whilst reducing anxiety. It starts with non-sexual touching. It goes on to genital touching and then penetration. When the couple is confident of adequate penetration. I don't know if people know of this Ullasnagar culture in Mumbai, Darpan Wood. So at some point in time in the Second World War, British Army was housed in barracks at the Ullasnagar area. These barracks had 3/4 wall and then there was this dome. And refugees from Pakistan, so-called Sindhi community, in a large number settled there. And a young couple came to me, was referred to me actually from the casualty as an emergency case, because this lady had a lot of anxiety, and those were the days when panic disorder was not classified, so we used to call it anxiety, you know, state, anxiety state. And we started talking, and this was about 9 o'clock in the night, and we said, "What is your problem?" The problem was that within the community, the girl came from a slightly inferior community of the Sindhi community speaking people than the husband, who was the third of three brothers staying in the barracks. He was the best educated brother and he married this girl whom he passionately loved. But every night, the moment they switched off the lights, the sisters-in-law, the elder brothers' wives, would keep taunting them. कैसी होगी लड़की, कैसा बच्चा पैदा होगा, गॉड नोज क्या होगा, क्या करते हैं, उसने तो कितने आदमी देखे होंगे, एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा. इट टुक मी सम टाइम टू एक्सप्लेन टू देम टू लर्न टू स्विच ऑफ द सिस्टर्स इन लॉ. एंड द आंसर वाज नॉट टू स्विच ऑफ योर ओन रूम लाइट. सो इफ यू डोंट स्विच ऑफ योर रूम लाइट, द सिस्टर्स इन लॉ विल नॉट नो व्हाट यू आर डूइंग एंड यू हैव योर फन. दिस वॉज ऑन अ वेडनेसडे. आई यूज्ड टू बी ऑन इमरजेंसीज ऑन वेडनेसडे इवनिंग. The next Wednesday evening at 11 o'clock in the night, I get a phone from the casualty saying a young woman has come bleeding per vagina, bleeding per rectum, and she insists on seeing you. Oh my God. I had lived a very good life and I knew there was no reason why a woman would have bleeding per vagina and per rectum because of me. I go and see her and there was this couple with huge smile from ear to ear because they kept the light on for the past 1 week. And the sisters-in-law did not know what was happening to the couple. So you got to find a solution which sometimes goes beyond what the textbooks say. And that's the importance of communication skill. We need to learn to talk about our patients as if problems with sexuality is not something out of the ordinary. And that it is something which occurs. People usually find their own solution. When they don't, well, we help you find the solution for yourself. Don't ever say, "I have solutions for you." A gentleman was very upset. Even a dermatologist friend of mine was narrating. His patients have their own expectations. And this gentleman, with a chancre on the penis, went with his dermatologist friend of mine at the Cooper with marked anger and hostility against all dermatologists. Because he says for the last 3 months after he got the Shankar, he had been visiting dermatologists. He had seen 5 of them. They would all make him stand on a stool, undressed totally. They would walk around him and then go and wash their own hand. So he said, मेरे को छूते नहीं है, करते नहीं है, ऐसा मेरे में क्या है कि उनको अपना हाथ धोना पड़े? मैंने कोई पाप किया है क्या? So you got to be very sensitive and learn to speak to the person and help the person to speak to sexually important people in their life. We often come across such a situation. What are your presenting complaints and what happened? Nothing happened. Ask me what did not happen. Okay? So tell me, what did not happen? Says, well, sir, it is this sex that we just had did not happen. It's so frustrating for a person to try and not happen. So that brings me to the last part of my talk. Should we use humor in sexology? It's a million-dollar question. I know Dr. T.S.S. Rao has strong views. We have done a workshop on humor in sexual medicine and the answers. First of all, we've got to realize that people want to find faults with others for their own failures. So there will be women who would say there are witchcrafts and witches who have done it. Do not fall into that trap. As a sex therapist, be particularly sensitive about sex, gender, sexuality and sexual orientation. Do not make a loose comment. Use of humor can be used differently. A good friend of mine would tell his patients, don't worry, you don't have any serious problem, but the fees are much more than a cancer surgeon's fees. So it would help appear to the person that kuch to hai nahi, itna bada bhi kyun kiya. Humor and help. There are several physicians who do not concur with the idea of benefits of humor in clinical medicine. There are concerns about whether the patients would get offended by poorly placed material or humor. And humor could mislead a physician who are searching for serious work in the literature. Science koi hasne ki baat nahi hai. But then humor.
टी एस सत्यनारायण राव हूँ, मैसूर का जेएसएस यूनिवर्सिटी, जेएसएस एकेडमी ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन एंड रिसर्च और जेएसएस मेडिकल कॉलेज में प्रोफेसर होकर काम कर रहा हूँ। और इंडिया में पहला डिपार्टमेंट है कि जो सर्टिफिकेट कोर्स और फेलोशिप प्रोग्राम वहाँ पे स्टार्ट किया गया है। अब जो बोल रहे हैं प्रोग्राम के बारे में, सेक्सुअलिटी और रिलेटेड इश्यू, ये सेक्स है ना, वो सब लोगों में क्या है कि बोले तो वो बात करने का नहीं, बोलने का नहीं, सुनने का नहीं, ये तरीके का आदत या टेंडेंसी बहुत है। और इसी के वजह से आदमी तो ज़िंदगी करना ही है, पर इसमें किससे बोलना, क्या करना, कैसे वो सोल्यूशन लेना, इसमें बहुत मुश्किल। ये वजह से क्या होता है बोले तो, वो डॉक्टरों से या प्रोफेशनल से हेल्प लेने की जगह में यहाँ पर वहाँ पर ट्रीटमेंट लेने का, और इनका बहुत एक्सप्लॉयटेशन हो जाता है। सेकंड थिंग, सेक्सुअल प्रॉब्लम्स बहुत कॉमन है, दुनिया के सब जगह में ये डॉक्यूमेंट हुआ है, और हमारा इंडिया कोई एक्सेप्शन नहीं बनता है। दूसरी बात क्या बोले तो, दुनिया बहुत आगे बढ़ गया है, क्या बोले तो इसके बारे में स्कूल से ही एजुकेशन देने का और बच्चों को जो ट्रेनिंग देने का वो करते हैं, पर अनफॉर्चुनेटली हमारा इंडिया में इसके बारे में जो कुछ मिलता है वो टीवी में या मीडिया या दूसरा अलग तरीके से, और उसमें साइंटिफिक के जगह में शायद थोड़ा बहुत, और लोगों में ऐसा बात है कि ऐसा वैसा लोग सब समझदार जैसे वो बात करने को जाते हैं, और उनको जो सलूशन मिलना है उसके जगह में शायद घबराने का और डराने का ऐसा सब हो जाता है। बहुत से सेक्सुअल प्रॉब्लम्स हम जो देखते हैं, इनमें प्राइमरी प्रॉब्लम क्या रहता है बोले तो, इनके बारे में प्रॉपर समझदारी नहीं रहती, क्या अवेयरनेस नहीं है। 90% ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम हम जो देखते हैं क्लिनिक में हो या और दूसरे तरीके से, खाली जाने माने वो उनके बारे में प्रॉपर समझदारी नहीं। इसका मतलब क्या बोले तो, लोगों को बराबर से समझाने से बहुत से लोगों का प्रॉब्लम्स आराम से सॉल्व किया जा सकता है। अनफॉर्चुनेटली जो डॉक्टरों के पास जाते हैं, हमारा कोई मेडिकल स्कूल में ऐसा नहीं कि सेक्स एजुकेशन के बारे में इधर टीचिंग हो या ट्रेनिंग हो, इसी की वजह से डॉक्टरों को भी ऐसा समझ में नहीं आता है कि क्या करना. सो हम समझते हैं कि इसके बारे में अवेयरनेस सब लोगों को मिलना है. और इंडिया का पॉपुलेशन समझो इतना है बोले तो मेडिकल एजुकेशन में इनको प्रॉपरली इनकॉर्पोरेट करना. हमारा कर्नाटक के बारे में बोले तो जो ऑल इंडिया लेवल पे थोड़ा ट्रेनिंग हुआ है, नेशनल काउंसिल ऑन एजुकेशन एंड रिसर्च NCERT जो बोलते हैं ना, वो हायर सेकेंडरी स्कूल लोगों को इसके बारे में समझाना करके, और इसके लिए ऑलमोस्ट 4 मॉडल तैयार करके वो रीजनल कॉलेज ऑफ एजुकेशन है मैसूर में एक 10 वर्ष के पहले, और लोगों को इसके बारे में फील्ड ट्रायल ऐसा सब हुआ. इसका मतलब क्या बोले तो जो बच्चों को पेरेंट्स समझना है वो समझाना है, वो पेरेंट्स को करने को नहीं आ रहा है. और स्टूडेंट्स क्या करते हैं बोले तो जो समझदारी है उनके दोस्तों के साथ, जिसको भी उसके बारे में कुछ पता नहीं. सो थर्ड इम्पॉर्टेंट कैटेगरी ऑफ पीपल जो लड़के या लड़कियां बात करते हैं कि वो टीचर्स हैं, वो हम भी समझते हैं. और इसका गवर्नमेंट का भी इरादा था कि वो स्कूल टीचरों को थोड़ा ट्रेनिंग देने से वो बच्चों को स्टूडेंट्स को इसके बारे में समझा सकते हैं करके. सो दिस वन ऑफ द वेरी रिमार्केबल मेथड था, और हम सोचते हैं कि वो सीरियसली इम्प्लीमेंट होना है सेकेंड इवन प्राइमरी स्कूल से मे बी सेकेंडरी स्कूल लेवल से इंट्रोड्यूस करना करके कर्नाटका में महाराष्ट्र में कुछ स्टार्टिंग हुआ, बट अनफॉर्चुनेटली वो थोड़ा पॉलिटिकल इश्यू होके वो जो स्टार्ट होना था बराबर से वो नहीं हो पाया. हम समझते हैं कि वो सीरियसली देखना पड़ेगा, गवर्नमेंट इसके बारे में सोचना पड़ता है. और अब जब समझते हैं कि दुनिया में बहुत से तरह के गड़बड़ी हो रहे हैं, वो अत्याचार का बात करते हैं, ऐसे वैसे बहुत सी चीज़ें, इसका मतलब क्या बोले तो लोगों को इसके बारे में समझदारी है बोले तो जैसा प्रोटेक्ट कर सकते हैं जैसा डील कर सकते हैं वो समझ में आएगा. इसके बिना हमारा जो फीलिंग्स है और जो बॉडी का चेंजेस है बराबर से रास्ता नहीं बोले तो
Your presentation made it very clear that it is a sort of counseling.
It's a compass.
The other one word, what we can add is actually nothing but behavior therapy. So, there are very systematic, normalized.
I said it's a psychotherapy. I didn't say counseling. Counselors can give it. People like to use the term sexual counseling. But I was very clear, I said it's a psychotherapy. And it can be various kinds of psychotherapy. It's actually, I don't think anybody has given the title, but it's a kind of a CBT.
So absolutely, you have made the point very clear, and I must acknowledge it. You must message what I am also adding in addition to what actually being spoken is that many of the times when people come with ED or PE and things like that, we like to maybe give some medications or maybe a little bit of talking and stuff. My idea is that every postgraduate and person dealing with sexual problems should practice sensor-focused sex education. Very easy, very systematic, very well-organized pattern, and what Marshall Johnson suggested has been modified to the Indian context comfortably, and it is beneficial.
Today, we are a pill popper society. A pill for every ill is the expectation. So couple comes and you don't prescribe anything, they don't like it. That doesn't mean we fall into the trap. So I spent quite some time telling them that these sexual pills are not established medical treatment. But 30% of the patients have placebogenesis. So if you want a pill, if it makes you feel good that you and your partner are taking pill, and if it makes you comfortable, I give you a pill, but don't ever prescribe a benzodiazepine, because if you prescribe a benzodiazepine, the couple may get going and sleep halfway through. So I do not give benzodiazepines. I give placebos, telling them that if it works, it's a placebo effect and not a specific effect. Do I prescribe hormones? No. Do I give them oral hormones? No. I tell them that's not my job, I'm not trained to do it. But you've been to a gynecologist, stroke andrologist, and they have not found a reason for it. Some andrologists give clofenazine in a small dose, and the internet medical graduate doctors, patients, they find out and they ask you whether clofenazine is a psychiatric drug, and I would tell them it's good for reasons other than mental health.
जैसा कि हमने देखा और सुना और आपको रूबरू भी कराया कि कैसे जो एक्सपर्ट्स आए थे उन्होंने मेल सेक्सुअल डिसऑर्डर के ऊपर बात किया, साथ ही जो सेक्स डिसऑर्डर्स होते हैं उन पर भी बात किया कि आप अवेयर हो सके, लोगों को अवेयर कर सके, साथ ही अगर आपकी फैमिली में किसी को कोई प्रॉब्लम है तो आप डॉक्टर से कंसल्ट करें, उसे छुपाए नहीं, और अपने बच्चों को भी सेक्स एजुकेशन के बारे में अवेयर करें। आशा करती हूँ कि आज का ये जो सेमिनार रहा है हम सब के लिए बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट मैसेज लेकर आया होगा। इसी के साथ मुझे यानी मनीषा को दे इजाजत, बने रहे हो इन्हें न्यूज पर। नमस्कार।